Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Murdo Fraser is joining us remotely this morning, and we have been joined by Stephen Kerr, MSP, and I expect Jackie Dunbar, MSP, to also be coming to committee this morning. Although they're not members of the committee, they will be attending the Grangemouth evidence session, and I welcome them to the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session. On the 22nd November, it was reported that the oil refinery at Grangemouth would be transitioned into a fuels import terminal, possibly by as early as spring 2025, with media reports suggesting a net loss of up to 400 jobs. This raises questions about the site's future as a key employer and driver of economic activity in the area, as well as Scotland and UK's energy and industrial strategy. Earlier this year, the committee heard an inquiry looking at a just transition for the Grangemouth area, and we visited the INEOS site. And at the time, we were not made aware of these plans. This morning is an opportunity to discuss issues, including the impact on jobs, the support for workers, the impact on the Scottish cluster, and fourth Green Freeport. We'll hear evidence from two panels this morning. And firstly, I welcome Ian Hardy, Head of Legal and External Affairs, Petro INEOS Manufacturing Scotland Limited, and Colin Pritchard, Sustainability Director, INEOS Grangemouth. And thank you for attending committee this morning. The committee was actually in session when the announcement and the news broke on the 22nd of November about changes to the refinery. And committee members, I think, were all very concerned by the news, given we had conducted an inquiry in the summer. Could I ask, first of all, when the workers were made aware of the plans and what consultation, if any, has taken place with the workers at the site?
Good morning, Madam Convener. The announcement was made on the 21st, as you've correctly identified, and the first people to hear of it were the workforce. As a shareholder group and as a management team, we were determined that they would hear first from the refinery, and as a result, we began a process that morning of informing the workforce, so 500 heads across three operating bases, of the news that we were announcing of putting in place the enabling works for the future transition to import operations.
And would you say this was it an unplanned announcement for workers? Were they aware that this was likely to be coming along, or was it a surprise announcement for them?
So were they aware of the specifics of the announcement on that day? No, but as a workforce there, well aware of the macroeconomic environment within which the Grangemouth refinery operates. And in fact, we do, as a management team, keep them regularly updated on the financial performance. So whilst on that specific day, no one was prepared for that news, I think in the round it's well understood that Grangemouth being an older asset, an energy and efficient asset, that as we move forward through the energy transition, it inevitably would transition from a refinery business into an operating business at some point. And really all the announcement was indicating was the start of that process. What it definitely didn't do was anything related to refinery closure. We don't know when that will be, but what we do know is that we have to put in place the enabling works necessary to allow us to move to an import terminal at a point in future.
But the announcement said the closure would be spring 25.
No, Madam Convener, the announcement didn't say the closure would be 2025. The announcement said that the process of enabling works will take up to 18 months, and we anticipate currently that we will operate through to at least May 2025. Beyond that, we don't know, because we don't know what the prevailing margin environment for the refinery business will be. But what we do know is that we have to act now to put in place the physical infrastructure to allow us to transition, on the basis that we do reasonably expect that over the medium to longer term, refinery margins will fall away and revert to loss making. And considering that the Grangemouth refinery business has, in the last decade plus, incurred losses of over $1 billion, it's entirely reasonable and prudent for us to put in place those physical mitigations so that we don't reverse back to that loss making environment.
So you're saying that the timescale isn't clear. The work is starting, but the timescale for the closure of work there isn't clear, and that leaves the people who work there in quite a suspended situation because they don't know.
I'd flip it around and say, in the alternative, we know What do we know? We know that the works will take at least 18 months. And what we wanted to do was make sure that the workforce were not surprised by suddenly seeing contractors on site at Finnart on the west coast and at Grangemouth on the east coast looking at modifications which they would clearly identify as being terminal enabling works. So we took the proactive decision to tell staff now. In the alternate, we could have waited till the very end of the process and when a decision to cut over had been made and just tell them at that point. But that goes against everything that we as a management team and as our shareholders wanted to do, which is honesty, openness and transparency. And that's what I think was inherent in our announcement. Yeah.
So why did the newspapers report it as spring 2025? So where did that come from if it wasn't part of the...
I think you'll be better versed than me on trying to understand why journalists do certain things. Grangemouth is critical national infrastructure. It's big news in any context. As I say, our focus was on telling staff first. And, you know, inevitably that message got out. You take the 18-month duration of the works from the November start date and you do get to spring 2025. And also, as we've discussed with colleagues across Scottish and UK government, there is a programme of turnarounds and CAPEX interventions that have to be made. And there is a big CAPEX hurdle in and around May 2025 where the refinery will have to spend, in order to get beyond May 2025, it will have to spend a very significant amount of money in the tune of £40 million in order to have a licence to operate beyond then. So there's two natural hurdles. One is the duration of the enabling works, and the second is the turnaround that must be completed by May 2025 in order that the business can progress for another 4 to 5 year cycle.
And can I ask, I don't know if you can share with us, when the decision was made? So the meeting with the workers took place on the 21st of November, but we had the inquiry in the summer, and this wasn't, you know, it might have been a recognition that there was a need for the plant to move towards net zero. And so plans like this were being discussed, but not on a timescale that's been presented to us. So when, and the workers found out on the 21st of November, so when was the decision made?
The formal decision made to commence with the announcement was made only a number of days prior to it. It had been in discussion, as I'm sure you'll be aware, for a period of time, but our essential point was that the workers would hear from us first. So Scottish Government were briefed in advance and had been aware of the concept for a reasonable period, as had UK Government. But, and we were unapologetic about this, we didn't pre-brief media extensively, we didn't pre-brief members of the committee extensively, because we were laser focused on the staff hearing the message from the refinery management team first. We owe it to them.
Can I just ask one other question? I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald. So in terms of the Green Freeport, to move from closing down the refinery to an import and export business, what incentives and what... Because it looks like the Green Freeport is costing jobs rather than creating jobs, because we're looking at losing 400 jobs at INEOS. So what are the... What factor does that play in this decision? Because it will be offering tax breaks and...
What factor did the Green Freeport make, to answer your question succinctly? None. It offers no meaningful benefits for the refinery as an operating refinery, where it may have...
It would. As an importing, it would, wouldn't it? If we're closing down the refinery and moving to importing...
Where we see a potential benefit for the Green Freeport is in the potential future development of a biorefinery on site, and that's where the package of measures in and around the Scottish Green Freeport may be beneficial.
Okay, I'll bring in.
I might just defer to Paul if there's anything else on Green Freeport, particularly from an INEOS perspective, that might be helpful.
No, indeed. The areas for the fourth Green Freeport that are identified, there are some areas within the refinery fence line, but those are areas currently undeveloped where, exactly as Ian says, there is the potential for incentives to promote biofuels and the future energy sort of provision that we will have once we've gone through the energy transition.
OK, there might be further questions on Green Freeports, but I'll come to Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, panel. I want to continue this discussion about the background to the decision to move towards this closure, whenever that may be, May 25 or beyond. So you talked about macroeconomic challenges. Are there economic challenges that only impact on Grangemouth refinery or is it the same issues that impact on the other five refineries in the UK and indeed across Europe?
Thank you, Mr. McDonald. So there's both. So if I take the Grangemouth specific ones first, Grangemouth is one of Europe's oldest refinery. From its configuration, it is inherently inefficient just by its nature of its construction, based back from 1950s and 60s. With that configuration, there is a higher unit cost of production that we bear at Grangemouth than I think the other refineries bear. And then if you look out with the immediacy of the refinery environment, the population that we serve, our commercial hinterland, it's a large geographic space, but a relatively small population. And that does obviously have a bearing on the economics of Grangemouth when you compare it to other refineries down in England, which have a greater population density in and around them. So all of those factors combined, as well as a projection of margins to decline in the future, mean that Grangemouth has been historically and will be in the future again a material loss-making business. And that's why we have to act now, put in place the infrastructure so that we ensure that we do not revert to that at a later date.
So you talked about the substantial losses that were made in 2020 and 2021 due to lockdown. But Rystad Energy highlighted that due to the Russian invasion of Ukraine, and I quote, catapulted refining from famine to feast in terms of margins. Was it a mistake for Petroenergos to cut the site's refining capacity by 30%?
So there's a couple of points there. The first, to take the Rystad report, they are correct insofar as the Russian-Ukraine war has led to an artificial spike in refinery margins due to, in effect, the sanctions and the constraint of diesel coming into Northwest Europe. However, what that doesn't change is the fundamentals, and we've just discussed exactly those. So there is an oversupply of refining capacity in Northwest Europe. I'm sure Rystad can and do report on exactly that. And then with respect to Grangemouth, we've just discussed some of the specific factors there that make it lower quartile performing in terms of its financial performance. As regards your specific decision of what we did in 2020, I think you're referring to when we reduced our throughput from 210,000 barrels to 150,000 barrels per day. We did that in response to the prevailing conditions at the time, and what we did was we reduced our throughput to better align with our inland demand. So that delta that we brought off at that point, the capacity that we mothballed, that was being exported into ARA, Amsterdam, Rotterdam and Antwerp. And it was being exported at a loss. So we were producing a product which we couldn't sell in our domestic hinterland. We had to export at a loss into Europe. So that is, on a self-effacing terms, that makes no economic sense. So the decision in that context to mothball that portion of capacity was absolutely the right decision.
You talked about the 150,000 barrel demand that currently is at the moment. What happens to that demand? Will it be that slack when you close the refinery, say, you know, 5 years' time or whatever it happens to be? What happens to that demand?
So the demand forecasts are evolving, and we have to acknowledge we are in the transition away from fossil fuels at the moment. There is increased penetration by EVs, by hybrids, and that's absolutely right. We're not arguing against that. But what that does is it reduces the demand for the product that we produce. So there comes a point where it simply becomes uneconomic for us to manufacture it. The refinery has minimum rates at which it can operate. And once you go below those, you go from that to zero. And what we're doing is ensuring that we don't get to that point. We get to a point where we can safely transition away at a point in the future away from manufacture, but at the same time, effectively bring through the import logistics.
When you cut from 210,000 barrels to 150,000 barrels, you must have thought the 150,000 barrel demand was sustainable, at least in the short term. So what my question is basically is, you also operate another plant in La Vera, France. Will that demand that you said currently is in Europe and you were exporting at a loss, will those customers now be served from the French refinery that you own, which is also another old BP refinery?
No. So the economics, the configuration, the operating envelope of La Vera is entirely different from Grangemouth, and the two just need to be viewed separately. There's no connection there to be had. As regards the inland demand at 150 barrels, as that was by design to meet the domestic supply. What we are saying is that over time, that domestic supply will fall away due to EV penetration, hybrids. And let's not forget, post-2030, the demand for our product will, we expect, fall quite sharply off a cliff due to the ban on new build petrol and diesel combustion engines. So I am stressing the point. What we are doing now is putting in place the enabling infrastructure so that we can continue to play the role of fuel supplier in Scotland, but not as a manufacturer at a point in time in the future.
So my final question is it's two parts. I wasn't able to find your financial accounts for December, the year to December 2022. It's not in Companies House. So could you say what the financial position was at the end of December 2022? And has a final decision been taken to close the plant, the refinery, and what would it take to keep it open for a longer period of time? You talked earlier about the CapEx decision of £40 million, but is there any other factors that we need to be taken into account to keep it open?
So as regards the financial statements, I presume there you're referring to Petronas Manufacturing Scotland Limited, which is the owner and operator of the refinery. Yes. And this is, we've had lots of questions from journalists and MPs and the like who've done exactly the same exercise as you. What I would urge is you can't just cherry pick one company in the legal structure. There is a series of interrelated companies that form the Grangemouth refinery business on the basis, it's a tolling and manufacturing joint venture. Only in totality will you see the whole picture of the losses flowing. With respect to PIMSL specifically, those accounts will be published shortly. They will likely show a modest loss, I would presume, because it's a tolling venture. It's not designed, it's meant to be a no-profit, no-loss company. So that, as I say, that's not the thing to focus on. And we can't.
It's a no-loss company. How did you make substantial losses? Because I picked the losses up from the manufacturing company.
There are losses inherent in PIMSL, but what I'm saying is within the broader group, you'll see the totality of the Grangemouth refinery business. You're just picking the manufacturer, but there's also the company that supplies the crude, there's companies that sell the products, there's others that provide infrastructure and utilities as well. And together, on a management accounting basis, you have to consolidate those.
So what was the group profit?
I don't know. Those won't be available.
Right.
Your second question was what steps could be taken to ensure the refinery continues to operate. So at this point, we are having discussions with Scottish Government and with UK Government, focusing on those sorts of questions. And I think to go into them at this stage would be inappropriate.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Evelyn Tweed, and then I'm going to come back to the issue of green freeports with Colin Beattie.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Does the planned closure accelerate the anticipated reduction in emissions associated with operations at Grangemouth, or did you already anticipate this as part of your net zero strategy?
So just so I'm clear on the question, the emissions from PMSL specifically, the manufacturing entity, are associated with the manufacture of refined product. As we transition ultimately from manufacturing to import, those emissions relative to PMSL will of course reduce. But I think it's fair to say there, and to take Mr. McDonald's point, there will still be a continued demand for road fuels and jet fuel for a period of time to come. Therefore, those Scope 3 emissions from the tailpipe will effectively still be in place for Scotland. As regards the broader INEOS, the broader question of emissions on site, I might defer to Colin on that one as Sustainability Director.
Yeah, so our initial plans for the roadmap, as we discussed with the committee in Grangemouth, were based upon the refinery being there as a basis, but we always knew that for all the reasons of policy and economics that Ian's outlined, that this was a possibility. So we are looking at, and it's probably worth saying that all of the plans that I discussed with the committee continue in place. So our projects around delivering a net zero, and particularly the next step for fuel switching to hydrogen and provision of hydrogen, and the tie-ins with the ACORN system and via national gas transmission to that, to the ACORN system, all of those plans continue as I'd outlined with the committee. I'm aware that there has been some comments about, and you raised it in the introductions, about impact on Scottish cluster. To be clear, we are continuing with our plans. There is no impact upon what we're doing. The outline and the scope that I described to the committee earlier this year is essentially unchanged. So we will continue. We will be producing blue hydrogen. We will have a CO2 export stream that needs to be stored. So our tie-ins via Feeder 10 and the Acorn project continue absolutely unchanged in terms of the scope.
Thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Just to go over a little bit the ground that you've touched on already, you're going to replace the refinery with an import-export hub on the side. Can you give a bit more detail about the expected markets for these imports and exports and the type of work that will be carried out on the new site?
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. So, to be clear, we will be importing, and we'll be importing transport fuels, so gasoline, diesel and jet fuel. We'll be bringing that in from international markets through our two operating bases in Scotland. So the plan as it stands is for us to convert Finner on the west coast, which is a deep water port, into a bulk diesel import node, diesel being the largest grade that we sell in Scotland. That will then be piped on a cross-country pipeline from Finnart through to Grangemouth on the east coast. At Grangemouth, there's a tankage modification programme to ensure we can accommodate bulk import of kerosene and gasoline, and also diesel if required. So that split that is designed to debottleneck access at Grangemouth jetty by bringing in the bulk diesel import on the west coast. And inherent in that plan is fuel resilience and fuel security. We will continue to sell the markets that we currently serve and the customers we currently serve. And in discussions with those customers, they have been supportive of the measures we're taking. So, you know, the type of people that we sell our product to buy from refineries, and they buy from import terminals as well. And there's a recognition in the marketplace that as we move through the transition, the energy transition, that there will be a move from manufacturing in Northwest Europe through to importation in Northwest Europe as well.
So to be clear, there is no export trade that's going to come to this hub?
No, by definition, what we'll be doing is importing product to serve our commercial markets in Scotland.
Okay, so it's entirely domestic?
Yes.
Would the markets for this extend south of the border to England as well?
That's something that we'll review at the time. So we currently have an asset in Cumbria in northwest England, which is rail fed from the refinery down to Dalston. And as we move through this process now of reviewing our forward plan, we will continue to investigate the other markets that we serve. And that includes Belfast as well. So we supply into Belfast. And again, that will be another port that we'll consider the economics around.
I'm just interested in the point of view of the expectations of the size of this hub and the scope of this hub. You've indicated domestic markets in the sort of northern part of the UK, shall we say. But that's limited to a certain extent. The expansion opportunities presumably are limited.
The expansion opportunities with respect to import logistics are what they are with respect to the geographic hinterland we serve. The expansion opportunities that I think you're referring to may be more pertinent when we talk about the context of a biorefinery, biodiesel production, SAF production, etc. going forward, which are part of another work stream that's being investigated by the business.
Now, we've touched already on the fourth green freeport, but I'm still not clear how this hub is going to impact on the fourth green freeport. Is it going to channel any of its business through there? What considerations being given as to how the opportunities could be developed?
Where I see, so the refinery remains within the footprint of the Green Freeport. But where I see the benefit of that is in the forward-looking projects in respect of the biorefinery potential and other low-carbon projects at Grangemouth. Those are where the fiscal concessions linked to that policy, I think, are given best effect.
And that's been factored into your plans going forward?
That will be factored in to our biorefinery project at the appropriate time as we go through the development funnel for that project.
Mm. OK, thank you.
Murdo Fraser. Who's joining us from Wotley, so it might just take a second to get Murdo on the screen.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Apologies. I was trying to unmute there. Good morning, gentlemen. Can I ask a couple of questions just to follow up on Mr. Beattie's line of questioning, just so I properly understand the situation? So, at present, Grangemouth is there. It takes crude oil from the North Sea, from elsewhere. It refines it. It then sells its product to markets, predominantly in the northern part of the United Kingdom. If the refinery closes, what then happens to that product that's currently coming from the North Sea? Where will it go to be refined?
Morning, Mr. Fraser. So whilst the refinery, as you'll be aware, is linked to the Forties pipeline system at Kinneil, we take very little crude oil via that system. That's a legacy arrangement inherent in the BP configuration of the site from time gone by. Our importation of crude oil is international. There is a trading team that focus on exactly that, looking at where can we get an appropriate specification of our crude diet at the best possible price, and that will be brought in from all corners of the globe.
Right, so two follow-ups then. In terms of the pipeline from St. Fergus, that currently goes into Kinneil. If the refinery closes, what happens to that?
I don't see the linkage there that you're making. I've been quite clear that the crude diet of the refinery from the North Sea via the Forties pipeline system is minimal. Our importation of crude currently is mostly via the west coast at Finnart, where we bring in large carriers in bulk and transfer that across the Cross Country pipeline. And it's that we're switching up to use as a bulk diesel import mode instead of bulk crude import mode in our potential terminal configuration.
Okay, so the closure of the refinery has no impact upon the gas pipeline?
Correct, Mr. Fraser. Thank you.
Right. Okay, thank you. So my second question, therefore, is for customers you currently have in the northern part of the UK who are buying your refined product, where in future will they source that product from?
The customers that we serve today, and it's business as usual today for them, they will be the customers that we continue to serve all the way through this transition.
And beyond this transition, where will they be purchasing their refined product from?
From Petroineos, as we move into our fuels import mode, we'll continue to serve them in the way that we've served them historically as a manufacturer of finished fuels.
Okay, but those products will be refined elsewhere, not at Grangemouth.
Oh, of course, yeah, by definition, those products will be, those finished fuels will be imported to site and we will sell them through all our existing infrastructure at the Grangemouth road rack. So there will be no change for any of our customers at the transition point.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now move over to Colin Smith to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I just come back specifically on the issue around jobs? The company often talk about the positive impact on local jobs, not only from the site, but also supply chain and contractor jobs. So can you just clarify the number of jobs that are affected? I think we've heard the figure of around 400 direct jobs. But what assessment has been made of the impact on supply chains and contractors and other local businesses as a result of the closure of the refinery?
So you're right, the current headcount at the refinery is approximately 500. Going forward, we anticipate that we will need about 100 heads for the terminal. Our modelling suggests that by the time we reach that transition date, approximately 100 will be eligible for retirement. And we anticipate that following cessation of refinery operations and during the currency of the terminal operations, there will still be about 50 employees required for decommissioning and demolition of the Grangemouth site for a period of probably up to about 3 years.
But there must be supply chain jobs, contractors jobs already in place at the moment in the refinery, as well as the people you directly employed. I'm just wondering what assessment's been made about any potential loss there, because the company constantly talk up the positive impact they have in supply chain jobs, but there's obviously going to be a negative impact. I'm just wondering what the assessment's been made of that.
There will be. So there is a supply chain that has and does support Grangemouth and refinery operations. Going forward, as an import terminal, the demand for services from that supply chain will inevitably drop, which is why it's equally important that in parallel with the cessation of refinery, we continue our studies around biorefining and the potential to bring those sorts of projects online. Because, you know, ultimately we talk about the just transition, but this is the just transition in action. And there's inevitability about us having to migrate from the fossil-based economy to the non-fossil economy. And that goes to the businesses, it goes to employees, and it goes to supply chain. So that's where I want to direct our focus going forward.
I agree. If we've got a just transition, the starting point is we need to know how many people are currently employed directly and indirectly with mm-hmm. the refinery if we're going to have a just transition to support those people. But I'm still not entirely clear what the impact would be numerically, I suppose, on supply chain jobs and what assessment's been made on that. But just can I come back to the 2025 figure? I mean, mm-hmm. you've indicated you're not clear if it will close then. I mean, what would stop it closing in 2025 that is making a loss at the moment? Your direction of travel has clearly assessed that you should be ready to close in 2025. What is going to change that you've not already built in between now and 2025? And what impact does that have on your existing workforce? Because employees in the refinery at the moment, highly skilled employees, are now effectively being told that their job is on a timer. They will be looking for other employment, presumably, because you can't give them any certainty beyond 2025. So what assessment have you made about the impact just on your daily operations of the fact you're likely to lose staff between now and 2025, skilled staff who be looking at opportunities elsewhere, presumably away from Grangemouth, because the work you're doing elsewhere on the site to bring other things on stream, frankly, that's long-term stuff. It's not going to create any jobs in the short term. So people are going to leave the area because of effectively your announcement.
So, Mr. Smith, you've correctly identified and referenced twice the highly skilled staff we've got on site, and they are the absolute focus of the management team presently. And you're right, you know, this news will be unsettling for them. And together with the unions and the employee forums, we've had very advanced discussions with them. And notwithstanding that we're not in a formal consultation because we've not started the closure process, we have put in place via the annual pay review a series of enhanced measures to protect them. So as of yesterday, I understand the unions will be recommending to their members an upgrade to the redundancy terms, as well as an above inflation pay rise. And it's for exactly that reason. We need to give them as much financial security as we can at this time in order that we can continue to operate as a refinery for so long as we need to, both while it's economically viable and also to put in place the enabling infrastructure for the terminal transition. So the employees are absolutely at the heart of our strategy.
So what incentive is there to stay till 2025? If you're a skilled worker who looks out with Grangemouth potentially, what is the incentive to stay there? Are you saying that if you stay, you'll get a financial bonus? I mean, I'm not clear if your job's going to probably disappear in 2025. You've not said anything at all mm-hmm. that suggests it's going to go beyond 2025. I think realistically we know it's 2025. What is the incentive for anybody to stay on that site if they're a skilled employee?
As I say, there is a package of financial support around our workforce to incentivise them to stay for that period. And it's business as usual. You know, as it stands today, the refinery is in full operations mode. We need our staff to stay, and therefore it's incumbent on us as a business to incentivise them to stay. If we didn't, we would just precipitate a larger problem for the business. And as such, we're doing everything we can to keep that workforce motivated and engaged, recognising, Mr. Smith, that this is a period of uncertainty.
And in terms of the supply chain, are you doing anything at all to reassure them, to suggest that there may be alternative? You'll know who your suppliers are, you'll know who your contractors are on that site. In terms of your future plans, are you in discussion with them about what it may mean for them? because they'll be uncertain as well, and that's a lot of jobs.
As we move through this process, and we've only recently announced it, we are having exactly those discussions, both with employees, supply chain, and all the other stakeholders, because there is a large envelope of people we have to reach out to and talk through and have exactly these sorts of discussions with.
Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thanks very much, and good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. Just I want to continue on lines of questioning around jobs and workforce planning and what you anticipate happening, I suppose, over not only the 18 months, but beyond that. You know, you've talked about the reduction in jobs that is likely to happen as the site shifts from refinery to an import hub. What I suppose I'm interested in the relationship between that and you've spoken about the biorefinery for the future. With the plans for the Green Freeport, you know, there was an estimated 50,000 jobs that would be generated by that. How do you see, I mean, if we're talking about a reduction to roughly 100 jobs with the import, you know, and you mentioned 50 that would be needed to decommission existing infrastructure, how do you see that playing into that broader sort of quite astonishing increase in job numbers for the site or for the area for the Freeport?
Morning, Mr. Chapman. I haven't been involved and I'm not aware of the data that supports the Green Freeport job figures, so that's not for me to comment on. What I can comment on and what I have commented on in respect to Mr. Smith and Mr. Beattie's questions isn't around the transition that we're putting in effect for our staff. And I guess I just have to reiterate the point that with respect to the Green Freeport, for us, the benefits there are best suited, as I understand it, to forward-looking projects that are currently going through the appraise project development funnel.
So there's not been a direct link then around workforce planning beyond the shift to an import hub?
The specifics of the Green Freeports and the figure that you've referenced there, no, that's not factored into our thinking. Our thinking has been of how can we do the best by the 500 heads that we have responsibility for as a business to manage.
Mm-hmm. And with the jobs that you anticipate continuing to exist with the import hub, what skills retraining, what professional changes will be required for the employees you currently have, and how will you support them through that?
So it's business as usual currently. So everyone is going through their training and they're keeping their tickets up, and that's essential, and that won't change until a decision is made. And even then, once we make the transition, there will be a package of measures, and I would anticipate with the support of Scottish Government and Falkirk Council, etc., to ensure that there is appropriate support for those employees who will not be transitioning into the terminal business. And that's something that we have a good track record of as a business in putting into effect. We did it in 2020, and I'm confident that we will employ the same rigour as and when we make the transition announcement with respect to refinery operations.
I understand what you're saying about the people who will no longer have roles. I'm talking about the people who will. Will they have, because I imagine that there'll be slightly different types of jobs, what skills training will be in place for them to make sure that they actually are, and that the jobs that they want to be doing?
So we are at the start of the project where we're doing the workforce planning in and around the terminal transition, and we have a highly skilled workforce now for operating the refinery, which is a top tier complex coma site. Those jobs will be directly relevant and useful and will fill the gaps we need for the terminal business as when we make that announcement. So I absolutely see a transfer from one to t'other.
And I suppose, again, another of the lines of questioning Colin had was around the supply chain and the indirect jobs. Do you see a role for your business in supporting any reskilling, upskilling and retraining for supply chain contractors and others, or do you think that's their business?
I imagine it will be a combination of both, Ms. Chapman. I think Scottish Government, Falkirk Council and Petronas will all have a role to play as and when we reach that point and we understand fully what the supply chain needs of the terminal business will be. I don't think it falls exclusively to any one party.
Okay. My final question on a slightly different point, not thinking about jobs and employees necessarily, but what engagement have you had or are you planning to have with the community around the site? Because obviously there will be an impact on them with the work that needs to happen over the 18 months. And then potentially, I don't know, but potentially it will have a very different kind of impact on them. The import business will be quite different from the refinery business in terms of the consequences, the impact on the immediate and not so immediate communities, residences, other small businesses.
The community that has grown up around Grangemouth has been there for a very long time and has seen it transition over a number of decades and years as it's developed. There will inevitably be a process of consultation with the local community as we move through the process. But I come back to the point now, we are at day one. No decision has been made. It's business as usual. You and your colleagues have raised excellent points about stakeholders who we have to speak to. Those discussions have to a large extent started and will continue as and when we progress through the decision-making process.
Okay, if I can just press you on that, you say those discussions have started. In what form have discussions with the community taken? Or what have they been to date, if they've started already? And are you using just the formal consultee mechanisms through, you know, community councils and that kind of thing, or are you looking at broader strategies of engagement?
At this stage, our engagement has been at the highest level. So you can imagine for us, key stakeholders in with respect to our local community will be the likes of Falkirk Council. So that's where our attentions have focused currently. And I think that's absolutely right, recognising that, yes, we've made the announcement, but we are at day one of the process. As and when we have an understanding of when closure will be, how it will be effective, and what that programme looks like, at that stage, you're absolutely right. We can go back to specific stakeholders and have specific discussions with them.
And do you expect the 18 months of work that have, you know, that you're on at day one of, do you expect that having a negative impact on the community with operations, as operations shift during those 18 months of work?
No, there'll be no direct. So during the currency of the engineering programme to affect the changes at Finner and at Grangemouth, that won't have any adverse effect upon local communities in the east or in the west of Scotland.
Thank you.
OK, thank you. Just for bringing in Kevin Stewart, Mr Hardy, you keep saying no decision has been made, but what part of this decision hasn't been made? Because it sounds like the refinery is going to close, we're going to move towards imports and exports. You've confirmed the kind of job changes, job losses we're looking at. What bit of the... You keep saying no decision has been made. What bit of it's not been made?
I don't think I can be much clearer, Madam Convener, and sorry if it's not landed. We have not made a decision as and when we will be closing the Grangemouth refinery. The positive decision we have made is to put in place the investment, the £10 million investment, in order to enable the logistics works on the west coast of Scotland and the east coast.
Scale. So the timescale is the final decision that's not been made, when this is going to happen, although most indicators seem to be spring 25.
So there is, I think, a recognition that the refinery will close. You know, we wouldn't be putting in place these measures if we had line of sight to the refinery operating for the next 20 years. So that's simply not the case, and no one in the refinery industry within UK or Scottish Government, I think, reasonably believes that. What we are doing is putting in place the infrastructure such that as and when the business makes that decision, there is no change from a continuity of supply position for Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Kevin Stewart, to be followed by Brian Motto.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. I want to go back to some of the comment that has already been made around about the Scottish cluster and the Acorn project. I'm going to quote you, Mr Pritchard, here. If I misquote you, you can tell me. But you have said that your plans remain unchanged around about the Scottish cluster and the Acorn project, and that you are continuing with those plans. Obviously, you're looking at substantial change here to the business. Could you explain why it is that you feel that your commitment and your plan works for the Scottish cluster and Acorn project remain unchanged?
Of course, and thank you for the question and the opportunity to clarify, Mr Stewart. In respect of the scope that I described of where we are switching our fuels across to hydrogen,
the key assets that we are focusing on, that we are turning across to hydrogen within Grangemouth, are our petrochemicals complex KG ethylene cracker and our utilities, so our combined heat and power plant and our utilities boilers providing steam and power to all of the site. I would remind everyone that there is still a petrochemicals complex and the Kinneil terminal from the 40s pipeline system that are there. In determining our design basis, and you'll notice what I haven't mentioned in there, we assumed no demand from the refinery for its fired heaters for hydrogen or to replace its current hydrogen unit that exists while it's a fossil fuel processing refinery. So the reason that I'm saying that our plans continue essentially as I discussed with the committee earlier in the year is that the design basis, our customers, are exactly the same as they were and they're unchanging. We have put ourselves in a position and made it very clear that if there is a future demand from the refinery, we will be there to provide a future demand, be that from a utilities or a fuel or a hydrogen from a transport basis, and that will all be actually upside and additional demand for our plans for Grangemouth's hydrogen provision. And if that comes from blue hydrogen, that will then be additional CO2 that we are capturing and putting through the ACORN system. So the reason that I say it's essentially unchanged is exactly that, because we didn't actually have a demand from the refinery in the first place that we were factoring in.
So there was no demand in your original business plan to ensure that you were supplying the refinery?
There's no direct demand for their fuel switching or to replace the hydrogen unit.
Okay. I want to move to a few other bits around about the biorefinery. I'd like to hear a little bit more about your plans for hydrogen, which you've already mentioned. And beyond that, I'd like to know where you're at in terms of looking at sustainable aviation fuel and the production thereof, which is going to be extremely important. And does the proposed closure of the refinery at a certain point, which you're unable to tell us at this moment when that will be, where does that put those ambitions? And beyond that, where do you think the refinery plans play in the minds of confidence of future investors and what you're looking to scope for the future?
Quite a lot to unpack there.
Quite a lot, yeah.
Do you want to hear first, so that just there's two separate projects, just so we're clear. There's the biorefinery project, which is the Petronas study. There's also the blue hydrogen project. Do you want to hear about both, or do you have a preference for one or two?
Just mix it all up, please.
No, that's the point, Mr. Stewart.
We've got a very short period of time.
I will speak about
summarise both very quickly, because I have more questions, as you would
imagine. I'll keep waffling in that case. With respect to the biorefinery, that is at an appraised stage, so that's very early commercial and technical feasibility. And what we're doing, it's a matrix-based approach. So there is a new build review. There also is a repurposing review based on the refinery's existing configurations. Then there is two sizes. There's effectively a mid case and a high case in terms of production. So, and that's trying to recognise whether we just focus on a domestic market or whether we then do what we had done previously as a refinery historically, which was export into ARA. Recognise, as you have, there is going to be a demand for these biofuels going forward. Specifically with respect to SAF, there's a few really important things we can say there. So in part, and it's something we've not discussed actually enough, I feel, as a business, we are reviewing the potential for importation of SAF. It's not as easy as just bringing in jet fuel in the way we currently do and piping it in and storing it and selling it to market. There is a separate piece of logistics and enabling work we have to do on site to accommodate that. That work is funded and is being done. And our plan in 2024 is to carry out a number of test cases of that where we import SAF from Europe and sell through the existing terminal infrastructure at Grangemouth to customers.
But why not manufacture SAF here?
Well, that's exactly, Mr. Stewart, what our biorefinery project will do. So the biorefinery project is looking at the feasibility of manufacturing biodiesel and SAF. Now, there is some really, and we can have a very long and detailed discussion about the hurdles to that, but there's two big ones that the committee should be aware of. With respect to SAF, you talked about investor confidence as well. The reason we're not seeing a large uptake of SAF manufacturing at scale and at pace in the UK yet is, I would argue, exactly that investor confidence point. There are some major challenges to the UK policy framework around that, two specifically. One, we know there's going to be a SAF mandate coming in, but we don't yet know what thresholds it will be at over what period of time. Therefore, by definition, how is a project developer are you expected to design, procure and manufacture a plant to meet a feedstock, a product demand you don't yet know is firmly there? And secondly, there's a big disconnect between the feedstocks that you can use for bio in the UK and in Europe. The UK government is proposing and is sticking to what's called a HEFA cap, which will mean and it is forcing industry to move to second generation technology with a lower technical readiness. And as a result, I fear, and the data shows, that by the time the SAF mandate comes on stream, there will not be sufficient domestic manufacturing in the UK to meet it, and we'll revert back to being a net importer of sustainable aviation fuel into the UK. And that's something that I think could and should be addressed in order to incentivise and push on the development of bioprojects in the UK. I think that's probably enough from me on the biorefinery. I'll hand over to Colin to talk about INEOS's blue hydrogen project, which is of equal significance.
Yeah, I'm just trying to clarify the question specifically around the blue hydrogen project that you'd like me to cover.
Just give us a brief summary. And, these plans, what bothers me around about the way that you're doing things at this moment is that there may be an impact in the future in terms of confidence, in terms of moving some of these projects forward.
So to be clear, the project that we've got is underwritten by the demand that we've got on site for hydrogen that comes from the petrochemicals complex and from the Fordyce pipeline system. So the projects that Ian was discussing that we could see in the future of biofuels and SAF development and other low-carbon hydrogen feeding into the transport sector, if they're given the right support and the right policy support, some of the aspects that Ian's discussing, also that they actually make commercial sense. At the moment, there is a general challenge with, which is true across the whole of the energy transition, in terms of our policies seem to be more directed at banning the old than they are in creating the future that we wish to move to. The latter is decidedly more complex, I admit. And an example in there, well, no, I won't go for the example. But so when you look at what we're planning to do, there should be investor confidence because we have a demand and offtake. And in fact, the way that the UK government's low carbon hydrogen agreements are set up, actually confidence over your offtake is absolutely key. Ultimately, that might even limit ambitions across the UK of these hydrogen projects being developed. So I would reiterate again, if we can get the right policy and support in for the future projects that we've discussed from the refinery, this is only going to be additional demand and should actually bolster and build on what is already a solid demand base for our hydrogen project.
Okay. I'm going to move a little bit over, because there's been talk of energy security. Previous members have asked questions around about the Forties pipeline and what comes in at Kinneil. You have discussed in some great depth around about the export that currently goes on to ARA. And you have talked around about a crude mix from international markets. In terms of the energy security aspect of this and carbon footprint, is there not an argument that more crude should come in that Forties pipeline to Grangemouth? Stopping the supply, because you've talked about Finnart and the pipeline being used for diesel, I've not heard anything around about petrol or kerosene or how that would come in to the import plan. From an energy security perspective, would it not be better utilising the Forties pipeline into Grangemouth more rather than relying on international shipping coming in to Finnart? General comment on that, and then I may have some specifics.
So I think let's unpack where you were going with this, Mr. Stewart. So first, with respect to the terminal, we're not talking about international crude, we're talking about international refined product. We've spoken about the reconfiguration of Finnart on the West Coast to be a butt for bulk importation of diesel. That inherently gives us strong security of supply. That is the most popular grade of finished fuel sold in the UK. By definition, that frees up capacity in the East Coast at the Grangemouth jetties. That debottlenecks access to that infrastructure for the bulk importation of gasoline and kerosene there, as well as back up logistics for diesel as well. And I might add, so in our current configuration...
It's the importation aspect that gets me.
Okay.
We're talking a lot about energy security, mm-hmm. right? And let's look at this from layman's terms. We have the North Sea Basin producing crude, right?
Correct.
And you are refining that crude, and you are refining that into various different products.
So right? The North Sea produces crude. Do we take much North Sea crude via Kinneil, to take your FPS example? The answer is no, it is entirely de minimis. Are we exposed from a fuel security international supply chain perspective today with respect to our operations? Absolutely, because we have to import crude internationally in the same way that
That's my point. Do we actually need to be importing as much crude, and can we not utilise the North Sea Basin and what it's producing to a greater degree? Now, I recognise, you know, that there are different types of crude and all of the rest of it.
Well, Mr. Stewart, I'll stop there, because there's different types. We're getting mixed up between crude and refined product. What we're seeing is that the economics of manufacturing refined product at Grangemouth in the competitive landscape within which it sits is not going to be viable in the longer term. So by definition, we're going to have to transition away from manufacturing, and adding on top of the $1 billion of losses already attributable to that business by moving to an import business. The alternative is unsustainable losses going forward, which is not a viable future and is not inherent in any just transition planning modelling.
I think we could go on for quite some time in terms of the competitive international market. And from an energy security point of view, there has to be changes to that market. And in terms of reducing carbon footprint overall, there has to be changes to that market as well. What I'm driving at is from an energy security point of view and utilising the North Sea Basin to the max to save on importing crude and product, would it not be better to utilise that pipeline from Forties to Kinneil more? And would it be beneficial for Petro Ineos, for the UK government in particular, to look at what can be done to help in terms of that energy security by investing in that energy security? Now, you know, I'm very well aware of the 2013 rescue plan, which of course led to a £9 million grant from the Scottish Government and £125 million of loan security from the UK Government. Is it time to look at security and loan security in terms of future energy security and cutting down on the carbon footprint?
I'll focus on two aspects, if I may, Mr. Stewart, just in the interest of time. Energy security is something that we take incredibly serious. Our proposal, our plans are designed to ensure exactly that and give Grangemouth a new life as a future fuels hub for decades to come. As regards whether UK Government and Scottish Government should be making interventions to maintain continued refining operations at Grangemouth, I'll leave them to make their representations directly.
OK, thank you, Convener.
Brian Mutt.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I'm just going to ask a couple of quick questions, just around clarification, so I understand exactly where we are. We understand they'll no longer be refining or importing and refining crude at some point at the plant, but you will be importing refined fuel into the plant. Can I ask what assessment assessment you've made on the impact on the decarbonisation process and where that sits, and also in the potentially just to clarify where how that impacts the production of hydrogen and SAF at the plant, if I could just get clarification on that.
So when the Grangemouth refinery stops operating, its scope 1 and scope 2 emissions will fall by definition, and I think that's to the tune of about 800,000 a year. However, there will still be demand. We will be importing product, and that product will be getting combusted in cars, buses, etc. in Scotland. So the scope 3 emissions for the country, I expect, to remain largely unchanged. And they will track in the downward curve, which tracks also the improvements in efficiency in engines and the decline in use as people move to EVs and hybrids, etc. Your second question on SAF, I think we touched on that with Mr. Stewart. So we are doing two things. One is there is a project ongoing to ensure that we can import SAF through Grangemouth going forward. And ahead of the mandate in 2025, we're actually planning on doing some test runs in 2024 to prove up the system, because the supply chain and the testing, etc., that we have to do for that product is quite different. And then SAF manufacture, it is an exciting opportunity. And that is an inherent part of our biorefinery project, which is, as I mentioned, Mr. Stewart, is focused on HVO, so biodiesel, and SAF, sustainable aviation fuel. And it's that would give you the domestic manufacture of those two key products.
I mean, it's quite an interesting web, if you like. We're not refining crude in Scotland anymore, so there will be a reduction in carbon production, but we are refining crude. We're almost offshoring our carbon production by refining it somewhere else. So overall, reality.
Right. Yeah. You're absolutely right, and we can't get away from that aspect. You're spot on.
Right. The other thing I wanted to ask around is around. It's blue hydrogen that is producing there, you discussed just now. You have an offtake at the moment for the blue hydrogen that you're producing. What is that a particularly promising area for development of the site? Do you have potentially looking down the line a much greater offtake of hydrogen?
Yes, so as you said, the current plans for the blue hydrogen plant will involve the offtake for our ethylene cracker and the utilities provision. So we will be in a position to provide low carbon steam and power across Grangemouth. That will supply the existing assets, and there will also be the potential for there to be capacity to supply steam and power to any other businesses that locate, just because we will have excess capacity the way we configured. So the opportunities for growing the hydrogen demand in Grangemouth are absolutely there. Clearly, from the aspects that Ian's outlined in terms of a biorefinery, but also the location in Grangemouth. I mean, I would go back to why the refinery is there in the first place. You've got the land, you'll have the logistics, and I'm working very closely talking with the likes of Scotia Gas Networks and National Gas Transmission, so with their Project H2 Caledonia and Project Union, which will link hydrogen. The intent is to link Grangemouth into a national 100% hydrogen supply system that would go the length of not just Scotland, but of the UK. And that will give the access that we could in order to be able to supply to anybody who would like to locate in Grangemouth. And also with our blue hydrogen production and linking into the Acorn project and National Gas Transmission's Feeder 10, we'll have the ability to take CO2 away from processes in the vicinity of Grangemouth as well, not just INEOS or Petroineos processes in the future. So in very many ways, the work that we're developing as INEOS Grangemouth through our first step, or our next step, I should say, on our decarbonisation plan, will actually set Grangemouth up quite well, very well, in terms of its linkaging to logistics to be able to make advantage of those hydrogen and CO2 links. It just needs the policy support in order to be able to make those energy transition investments come to Grangemouth from both our companies and others.
Do you have the thought been there, or do you have the capability of moving on to green hydrogen? Just a personal question to me.
I'm very at pains to describe low carbon hydrogen demand, because there's blue and there's green. Again, I think I outlined when we had the committee in Grangemouth that we are moving with blue hydrogen first. It's got deliverability, which means we can move quicker in the quantities of hydrogen that we need in Grangemouth. And part of the reason we can do that is by taking advantage of the existing infrastructure from our previous fossil fuel-based economy, so natural gas coming in from the North Sea and coming down. So to be able to get CO2 stored about 400 kilometres away from Grangemouth, 2.5 kilometres safely under the seabed, requires 15 to 20 kilometres of new pipeline. And the rest of it is reused pipeline. So deliverability is really strong. That's the reason we're moving faster with blue hydrogen. But the end consumers and what we're doing is switching to hydrogen as a fuel. So we can use hydrogen from any source whatsoever. The end user doesn't matter. So green hydrogen, wherever that's generated, can be used in the future as well from that as an energy source, which is why we're trying to link up, or we are intending to link up to SGN's H2 Caledonian and Project Union to the Grangemouth site, which would then make hydrogen from any source available to anybody who wishes to locate in the Grangemouth area.
Just a final, very, very final small question that has been niggling away at me for some time. The decision that was made, has there any impact been on that decision being made from the hostility that seems to be being heaped upon the oil and gas industry at the moment? Did that have any impact on the decision-making process?
No. Okay. It's a macroeconomic assessment.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask a couple of quick questions? In terms of importing, moving to an importing business, will any assessment be made of where the refined product is coming from and how it is being refined? Because the standards and other, I mean, you could look at, you know, international standards, they're not, the UK does have a high standard when it comes to health and safety and the workplace and, you know, and the products we produce. How can we be assured that what is coming in is going to reach that standard? Or is there any assessment being made of whether it does or not?
That will and should form part of the assessment as we transition now through this period of planning. Any product we bring in will meet relevant international standards. Of that, I have no doubt, Madam Convener.
Okay. And other question is around, as I said at the start, we had a committee inquiry into a just transition. The way in which this announcement has been made, you know, it looks like a sharp and a sudden decline. Out of the 400 jobs that will be lost, what proportion is that within the site? Because the whole point of a just transition is to try and not repeat the mistakes that we saw in the mining industry, for example. And unfortunately, the way in which the announcement has been made looks more like that than it does in terms of what we're looking for a just transition.
How do you mean in the way the announcement was made? What's your concern as regards the communication?
Well, because we're all sitting in the committee having done an inquiry a few months before, and it comes out during the committee meeting that 400 people are about to lose their jobs at the site. That is quite a significant number of jobs at a pace that I don't think the committee expected. Well, we recognise there's a shift away from refining and from the use of oil and gas, not at the speed at which 2025 would suggest. And we'll pick up questions with the Cabinet Secretary who's coming in next around what a just transition actually means, because from the outside, I have to say, this doesn't, at this point in time, look like a just transition for Grangemouth.
Your views on what do and do not represent a just transition are well noted, and I'll be interested to hear what the Cabinet Secretary has to say with respect to that as well.
Okay, thank you. Is there any other questions from Stephen Kerr?
Yeah, but Mr. Hardy, you do accept the narrative of this closure is that there are going to be hundreds of jobs lost and potentially thousands of jobs lost with a devastating impact on the area around Grangemouth, the Falkirk area. You do accept that narrative?
The figures as regards job losses haven't yet been finalised with respect to the terminal business transition as and when that materialises. And, Mr Kerr, I don't recognise the thousands that you're referring to.
OK, so that is your view, that the impact on this suppliers and contractors, which are thousands of jobs in relation to the Grangemouth site, that you don't accept, you don't recognise that as a potential impact?
No, I said I didn't recognise where the figure had come from.
Oh, but you understand that that's the nature of the calculation of the impact?
Well, I don't have for you a calculation on the supply chain impact. What we do, there's modelling that can and is done, and there's multipliers that are used to ascertain supply chain impact that we can discuss.
So what is your modelled impact on the supplier chain of a potential closure?
So the typical modelling number uses a multiple of 7. That's taken from the Chemicals Industry Association. But I think that belies the fact that within that number, that not everyone involved in the supply chain works exclusively for the manufacturing business, and not every business will have no part to play in the future transition. So if you've got a more credible data set, then that would be a good point to start.
Well, I think if your 7 times is right, then we're talking about thousands of jobs. So I was interested in your reply to Brian Whittle about the background to this decision. Why on earth then, given what your response was to Brian Whittle, why did Andrew Gardner, your chairman, make the extraordinary statements he did just a month before the announcement of the closure? He said the future of Grangemouth was on the line because of the policies that were being pursued by the SNP and Labour.
Is this that's Independent on Sunday article?
No, this was reported in a number of outlets. I've got in front of me a report from the Daily Telegraph.
So there was
but there are direct quotes.
If you've got the direct quotes there, I can assure you, if it's speaking of the oil and gas policy having effect on Petronas, Mr Gardner was roundly misquoted.
All right, context. So this is the quote. We want to keep jobs in manufacturing here, but Labour hasn't understood we need supplies. I need gas ready, cheap and available as a feedstock.
So, Mr Kerr,
is that wrong?
That is entirely wrong, Mr Kerr. My understanding is that Mr Gardner was speaking about the need for natural gas supplies to be maintained in order to have a feedstock for the blue hydrogen project, which form a key pivotal part of INEOS's decarbonisation strategy for the Grangemouth cluster. So with respect, and it's really important, Mr Kerr, it's really important to recognise that was a wholesale misquoting of what Andrew Gardner said.
Okay, I accept what you're saying.
Thank you.
I just very quickly ask some very specific questions, because people...
We're expecting the Cabinet Secretary in about 5 minutes.
So. Okay, I should be very brief, because people are rightly concerned about this. It's widely regarded by analysts, I'm going to quote Alan Gelder, who is an analyst at Wood Mackenzie, that the hydrocracker unit that produces the diesel at Grangemouth went down. The line went down in April and has not come back up. Diesel is the most profitable product line coming out of the refinery, if I understand that correctly. So why has the hydrocracker unit not been put back online?
The hydrocracker is not online for operational issues, which we've had two. We're in our second root cause analysis now. Are imperative. As you've said, it's key to, it's the heart of the refinery, it's a key upgrading unit, not limited to diesel only. It is essential for the commercial viability of the refinery that we get that unit back up and running as quickly as possible. It is in everyone's interests that we do that, Mr Kerr.
So the reports that some of the repair and maintenance work connected with the refinery had been stepped down, and that this led to an increase in breakdowns, including the hydrocracker. What's your response to that?
I have never seen such a report, and I can assure you the care and maintenance programme for the refinery business continues on foot, as it has done historically and as it will do going forward. We are a top-tier coma site. Health and safety is the critical concern, full stop.
The impact of the refinery closure on INEOS O&P, which is also loss-making, I think it lost £300 million, last year, what will the impact on that, the viability of that operation be, given the fact that there is input from the refinery to the processes of INEOS O&P?
The feedstock integration is entirely limited. There is a sharing of corporate and commercial services. Beyond that, the linkages are few and far between these days, Mr. Kerr.
Okay, and one last comment, one last question for me really is, timeline, when did you notify the UK and Scottish Government? I mean, I've been involved in the closure of plants myself. Mm-hmm. These things don't happen in a few days before you make an announcement. They take months of planning, intricate planning. So when, so the idea the decision was made and it was announced in a few days is slightly disingenuous, I think, to suggest that, because this was obviously something that was a long time in planning. So when did you inform the UK and Scottish governments of your intention to make an announcement on the day you did?
So you're entirely right. The planning for this is a long-term piece, and it has been considered in the round for a good while. Both Scottish and UK governments were aware of the concept of this and have been for a number of years. I'm sure Madam Convener, and you'll pick this up with Mr. Gray later on, we made the formal notification to UK government as required under the Energy Act on the morning of, and we similarly made a formal notification to the Scottish Government on the morning of. But that is
that wasn't the first they knew about
but
it.
No, that's what I'm saying. That is in addition to them being aware of the concept and the studies and the planning of the potential for it for well over a year prior.
Well over a year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr.
Okay, thank you. That now brings us to the end of the evidence session. I thank you to Colin Pritchard and Ian Hardy for attending. I will now briefly suspend the meeting as we have a changeover of witnesses. I now welcome our second panel this morning to discuss Grangemouth. Neil Gray, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy, Fair Work and Energy, who is joined by Kevin McDermott, Head of Critical Energy Infrastructure and Commercial Projects, Energy Industries Division, and Sue Townend, Interim Deputy Director, Energy Industries Division, both with the Scottish Government. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, colleagues. And thank you very much indeed for having me along again this morning. I welcome the opportunity to discuss with you the emerging situation, as far as we understand it, at the Grangemouth Refinery. And I both welcome and value your support on this important issue. I recognise that this is more than an unsettling time for the workforce at the Grangemouth Refinery, and reiterate here this Government's absolute commitment to doing all we can to support them. I also recognise the potential impact of this announcement in the longer term for supply chain businesses and commit to ensuring that any subsequent decision that is taken takes cognizance of the wider economic impacts for business and for local people and communities. And I think it's important to acknowledge the role that Grangemouth has played nationally and locally as part of our industrial infrastructure. It is Scotland's largest industrial site and is in an integrated cluster of strategic infrastructure with expertise in downstream oil, chemicals, petrochemicals and innovation. It is also hugely important for logistics as Scotland's largest port. There are three major industrial sites, the Petronius Fuel Refinery, INEOS and OIP UK, which focuses on petrochemicals, and INEOS FPS Oil and Gas Pipeline. Together, these three businesses employ around 1,800 of the 2,000 employees at Grangemouth. The Petronius Refinery is the focus of the recent announcement, and the refinery itself dates back to 1924 and is currently owned and operated under the terms of a joint venture formed in 2011 by INEOS and PetroChina. In those early days, a century ago, which was before the exploration of North Sea oil, the refinery solely relied upon oil sourced from across the globe, much like its operation today. It currently has 500 direct full-time employees and delivers £150 million worth of GVA annually. Grangemouth is Scotland's largest industrial site, as I've said, an integrated cluster of strategic infrastructure with expertise in critical elements of our economy. And as I've set out, all of this out to make clear how important the site is, and indeed the refinery is to us. That is why we're focusing on working with the refinery management and staff to start that transition to the future. The First Minister and I have, as you would expect, met with the refinery senior management team to receive an update on what this announcement means, and subsequently met with shareholders yesterday. It remains our understanding that this announcement is not a decision at this point to close the refinery, but a decision to start the necessary preparations to have the potential to transition Grangemouth to an import terminal. During those meetings, we stressed the importance of ensuring workers are at the centre of any decisions the business takes on the refinery's transition. The business agreed on the importance of working collaboratively with the Scottish Government and trade unions throughout this transition period. Likewise, I have also met with and written to Unite the Union and the STUC, and we are aligned on the imperative of securing a just transition for Grangemouth and the industrial cluster and its workforce. So it's our intention to publish that just transition plan by spring next year, and I'm sure that you will want to discuss and hear more about that work during this and subsequent sessions. So I just want to finish by reminding the committee that the responsibility for the security of fuel supplies lies with the UK government, and therefore contingency planning relating to fuel supplies are the responsibility of the Secretary of State for Energy Security and Net Zero. You'll be aware that I have written to the Secretary of State and have also had a constructive meeting with Minister Graeme Stewart, who is Minister of State for Energy Security, and Minister John Lamont, Parliamentary Under Secretary of State at the Office of the Secretary of State for Scotland, who have both assured me that the appropriate plans are in place in the event that there is any disruption to fuel supplies from Grangemouth. It is my intention and hope that we do continue to work constructively as things develop, not least to ensure that we prioritise the well-being of the highly skilled workforce, and that any final decision safeguards the business's role as a supplier of road and air fuels for years to come. Thank you, Convener. I look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I don't want to disappoint the Cabinet Secretary, but this morning it sounded like the decision had been taken to close the refinery, and you described it as a potential to move. It sounded like there were clear intention to move. The dispute this morning just seemed to be around the date, whether it was spring 25 or some future date. But the evidence, I don't know if other committees agree, but the evidence we heard this morning didn't sound like this was really a decision that was up for much discussion. I'm just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary had a chance to listen to the evidence this morning and whether that reflects discussions he is having.
I heard part of the session. I was at another event on the energy sector, actually, earlier on this morning, so I didn't catch the first part of the evidence session. But regardless, I think that's a fair assessment. I think that there is a transition that is going to be had at the Grangemouth site, and with respect to Petrianias, actually, their investment in coming forward with an import terminal ensures that whenever a decision is taken to end the refinery elements, that there is still an industrial capacity there, and it protects the fuel security for Scotland as well, which is an important consideration. I think there is a discussion to be had, which is what I have been having with the joint venture shareholders and the site management around the factors that influence the decision on the timing of that decision. And those discussions are ongoing. And I'm grateful for the fact that the UK government appeared to be at the table for those discussions as well. And I'm hopeful that through future meetings, we're able to at least understand the process by which they are taking that decision, and whether there's anything that can be done to extend the life of the refinery. But I don't wish to pose any further question about the challenge that there is here, given part of what the evidence you've heard this morning on the macroeconomic elements that are at play here and the reason for why this decision has been taken.
Now, you know that the committee did an inquiry into just transition for Grangemouth in the summer, and from the outset, this announcement was made during our committee meeting 2 weeks ago. I think it was a bit of a shock to members that the announcement was made in the way it was and the timescales that were attached to it. And that we have concerns that doesn't look like a just transition to us after the work that was done in the summer, to then have this type of announcement with a fairly 400 jobs is a lot from the portion of the site. It is four-fifths of the amount of the refinery, but overall on the site it is quite a lot of jobs who will be lost from the site. I mean, how does this affect the government's just transition plans? Because this looks, from the outside, like what we went through with the mining industry, and that's what we're trying to avoid in the current situation that we're in.
I would absolutely agree with you that we're looking to try to avoid the way in which deindustrialisation has been taken to communities in the past, communities that you represent, convener, communities that I represent in Airdrie and Shotts as well. Absolutely looking to avoid that. The work that we are doing on our Just Transition plan for Grangemouth is continuing. I'm hoping that we have a date now set for a ministerial element to the Grangemouth Future Industry Board that I'm hoping that UK ministers will be along at as well, so that we can discuss the impact that this has upon the work that we're trying to achieve for the Grangemouth site. And colleagues have already articulated some of the potential options that there are for future investment and future industrial activity at the site. I think in terms of the jobs, those are still to be finalised. We're still to understand the full detail over what the refinery losses can be made up for in terms of the import terminal, and obviously looking to push as hard as possible to ensure that whenever a decision is taken, that we're protecting as many jobs as possible for the reasons that you articulate. And obviously, we're looking in a wider sense to make sure that we are seeing as many job opportunities to retain highly skilled workers in the traditional oil and gas sectors into the green industrial revolution that is coming, and ensure that we can see a line of sight for workers who are looking to transition to be able to do so and remain here in Scotland.
I mean, for the Grangemouth area, it's not just the 400 jobs, and I think people recognise the 400 jobs are people who are very highly skilled, and one thing we constantly hear at the committee is industries can't get the skilled people that they need. So you can anticipate that those people who are high skilled will have transferable skills, but the impact on the wider community in terms of, I think other members will pick up on supply chains, but there's supply chains and the wider community, that's where the just transition is meant to be delivered.
Yeah.
In terms of the government's plans, part of the Just Transition plans was to gain a fuller understanding of the impact of the site on the wider community and the supply chains and the economic impact of changes at the site. Is that anticipated to still be part of the Just Transition plan, which is delayed? The concerns is that by the time the plan is published, it will be redundant, given we've had this recent announcement. So can we, what can we expect in the plan in spring? And will it take cognizance of this recent announcement?
Absolutely. It's absolutely central to that ongoing work, and has been the case through its development. I think you've repeated again that you know, 400... that is an assumption rather than a definite.
To be honest, we didn't have any pushback from any of us this morning that it wasn't 400 jobs we're talking about.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm just saying at this stage it's still an assumption rather than a definite, and we are looking obviously to do everything that we can to make sure that we're maximising the number of jobs that are retained at the site, and also it can be retained amongst the wider community, because I absolutely understand that Grangemouth is a hub of industrial activity and brings with it investment in the wider community and a supply chain that feeds it. I think Mr Hardy articulated the fact that there will be ongoing business based on the import terminal that will ensure that there is still a business opportunity there, and it is a complex supply chain that feeds a number of different aspects of the Grangemouth site. So we're still assessing alongside the business what the likely impact is going to be on the supply chain, but I'm hopeful that we'll be maintained in as strong a position as possible, and that is part of the reason why we're carrying on with the work of the Just Transition Plan, and also looking to see a further meeting with ministerial involvement, both the Scottish and UK governments, of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board early in January. I think the date of the 18th has been proposed in order so that we can examine exactly these types of questions, Convener.
Mm-hmm. I mean, how often does the Future Industries Board meet, and how often does the government meet with them?
On a regular basis, both at ministerial and official level. I'm not sure the date of the last meeting at official level was.
The last one was last week.
Okay.
The last one was last week, and before that it was about 6 weeks previously, I think. So it is meets reasonably regularly, and it's across the public sector.
Okay. I'll maybe focus on the issue of jobs, as that has come up. And the members who previously asked questions, would they like to come to Maggie Chapman?
Thanks very much, Claire. And good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for being here this morning. Colin and I talked about, tried to understand a little bit more about the impact on jobs with the panel earlier. And I take what you say about the 400 being an estimate. It's not certain yet. I think one of the things that I found quite concerning was there didn't seem to be any analysis done or any thought to actually understand the consequences for supply chain, for the indirect jobs on the refinery. Now I know that's only one element of the work that happens at Grangemouth, and although we didn't go into it in any detail this morning, you know, the other operations will still have the indirect supply chain work, contractors, that kind of thing. But I'm wondering what assessment the Scottish Government has done or is planning to do, and I suppose this feeds into the Just Transition Plan as well, because we've heard suggestions actually around the Freeport proposal, that 50,000 jobs could be created in you know, associated with that. Obviously not all at Grangemouth and not all related to the refinery. But I'm just wondering what your understanding is of the data we have, the data we need, and the plans to get, to actually understand the consequences for supply chain jobs, because I don't think we got any information on that earlier.
So there's a couple of elements in there. First, around the jobs and the assumption around potential losses. As I said in my introduction, I had very good and constructive meetings with Unite the Union and with the STUC around this, and they are working very closely with the management and the JV around making sure that as much protection as possible is given to the workforce, and also that there is as much of a workforce retained in order to ensure that the refinery is operational for as long as that decision is alive. In terms of the work on the supply chain, that, as I said, is featured in the work of the Grangemouth Future Industries Board and the work that we're doing around Just Transition Plan. But I would say that the types of supply chain operations, such as the logistics elements, are going to be still there, because when it's an import terminal, there is still going to be a need to see the logistics from the site move to the forecourts. Mm-hmm. So there are still going to be supply chain elements that will be retained as part of this. But we're looking to try to make sure that we're assessing this as acutely as possible, working with the joint venture around understanding to a greater extent, as Ms. Chapman has challenged, to understand what the potential impact could be on the supply chain.
Thanks for that. And I suppose one of the elements of the work that the industry board is doing now, and also will feed into the Just Transition Plan itself, I presume, is around skills, upskilling, reskilling shifts that are required. I think there was an expectation that there would be very clear shared responsibility, I think it's probably the kindest way I can put it, between the Scottish Government Council, the joint venture, and possibly others as well, to secure not only the upskilling, reskilling, retraining needed for the current employees who are retained, but for supply chain workers as well.
Yeah, that's a fair assessment, and absolutely what we're working on.
Can you say a little bit more about that?
Well, that absolutely is central to the work of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. It's going to be absolutely central to the Just Transition Plan that's published, because you cannot have a Just Transition without having a Just Transition for the workforce. So, of course, it's central to the work we're doing.
Okay, so Susie. Yeah.
Can I just add that in terms of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, it has representation across the public sector and includes people from Falkirk Council, from Skills Development Scotland, from Forth Valley College. And so there is already a lot of discussion in the conversation that we had last week. We were already starting to discuss how the college, how SDS could be involved in exactly the sort of support that you're asking for in terms of both the existing workforce, the supply chain, but also thinking about the wider impact of the Grangemouth community and how we ensure that young people continue to see Grangemouth as a place to live and work and to have well-paid, successful jobs in the future.
Okay, thanks, Susie. That's really helpful. My final question on this kind of issue is, earlier Ian Hardy said that this is the Just Transition in action. Those were his words. It goes to the business, employees and supply chain issues that we need to deal with. And I'm wondering whether I suppose I have a little bit of an anxiety. There can be an industry shift, a change as we're anticipating from a refinery to an import hub. That's a change, but it doesn't necessarily speak to the just transition. It's a transition, in that it's a change. And I'm just wondering where you see this in. You said earlier in response to a question from the convener that this will clearly be part of the Just Transition Plan that I appreciate is still being worked up and yet to be published. But I just wonder how we are ensuring that it's not just a shift and we're not just, saying, yeah, OK, we will retain jobs. We will have maybe fewer jobs over here, a few more jobs over here, but actually we're talking about the transition as a whole. It's not just a shift from one kind of industrial process to another. There's social the social elements around it, as well as the economic and industrial elements too.
So I thank Ms. Chapman for that. I think the critical element here is around making sure that we continue to work on some of the other opportunities that are available for the site around carbon capture and storage, around the absolute central place that the Grangemouth site plays within the Scottish cluster, but also the questions that were previously raised around hydrogen and the potential for a biorefinery as well. Those are absolutely critical in ensuring that we see not just a shift, as Ms. Chapman suggests, but also a transition. And I think on the hydrogen and the biorefinery parts in particular, that is a transition as opposed to just a shift.
Okay.
But those elements, obviously, and Ian Hardy and set this out, are works in progress and areas that we still need to make sure that all partners are looking to drive forward as quickly as possible.
OK, I might have a couple of other questions, but on...
OK, thank you. And just before, I was going to say if Colin Smith had any questions around the workforce, but I'll just go back to the issue of the board. So when we did our inquiry in the summer, we did express some frustration around the future... what are they called again?
Grangemouth Future Industries Board,
because as a board, they weren't able to come and give us evidence because they didn't constitute themselves as a board. They were really a discussion forum. And Richard Dixon has recently written an article. He's expressed frustration at the lack of activity from the board. I understand the last minutes that were public were December 22, so while they might have met, I don't know how transparent they are. And I don't know if you have an idea when the board's priorities are going to be available. That still isn't for 23-24. We're almost at the end of 23 and we're faced with news that we weren't expecting at this stage from Grangemouth. Mm. I mean, the committee would look for some assurances that the board is working effectively and is filling the gap that is there in terms of planning the transition. But we're still waiting on the government's plan as other issue.
So there are two elements there. One is that we're publishing our Just Transition plan early next year, so to answer that final part of your question, Convener. And in terms of the work of the Grangemouth Future Industries Board, that is continues to be active. It continues to be working, and I'll make sure that the activities and the forward work of the board is shared with the committee, and I can follow up in correspondence on that unless Susie's got further information she wants to impart right now.
Yeah, maybe...
It'll do it automatically.
It does automatically.
Oh, sorry. Maybe I can just add a little bit on the GFIB. So we've been talking in the Grangemouth Future Industries Board about whether it could be slightly changed in order to take more account of the wider set of stakeholders. So at the moment it's really set up...
Which was a recommendation of the committee.
Exactly. So at the moment it's set up as a really public sector body focused board. And the plan going into the new year, which we're starting to discuss with a range of stakeholders, is bringing on a much wider range of stakeholders to involve the community, to involve businesses working in the area, and also to involve ministers both from Scottish Government but also UK Government. And UK Government have already expressed a desire to be involved with that, and that's something which we're going to be taking forward in January. So the board will be slightly restructured in order to take account of the recommendations of the committee. And perhaps just to say one final thing in terms of the points you made earlier but also the points Ms Chapman made around the Just Transition plan, is that we're really keen that this is a plan which is not imposed on the local community but is co-developed with the local community. And therefore, there's been a series of stakeholder engagement events with businesses, with workers, and that's now going to go out to the community to have a discussion with them about what they see their vision to be. And that will then feed into what becomes the GFIB vision going forward. So the two sets of work are inextricably linked, that the work we're doing in terms of engagement and developing the Just Transition plan for Grangemouth will really inform the way the Grangemouth Future Industry Board is constituted and takes its work forward. And the vision should be available, I would say, probably in the next couple of months after Christmas. But that's subject to what we hear from the community and other stakeholders. We think it's really important that they have their space to say what they want, because they'll be the ones that are most directly affected.
But there is a recognition that the Grangemouth recent announcement does impact on a Just Transition plan significantly, because we've kind of moved at a pace that I don't think was anticipated when the plan was originally being drafted.
I think it will impact on what goes into the plan for sure, but in terms of the timing of the plan, we're still expecting to publish it in spring next year.
Colin Smith, did you wish to come in any questions around?
Yeah, can I just follow up on some of those points? I mean, given the direction of travel we've had for some time, the policy decisions in relation to net zero, that the closure of the refinery itself won't come as a surprise to the government. That was always likely to be the case. So just for clarity, can you tell us when you would say, Cabinet Secretary, when the government were aware that the refinery was likely to close. Not the specific announcement around the timescale that seems to suggest 2025, but when would you say the government were aware the refinery itself was likely to close?
Well, I think that's a fair comment, and I think it's a fair assessment that, you know, a century-old refinery that has been loss-making and has received intervention at numerous points over recent years, there was going to be a risk around its future, especially when it's competing with super refineries elsewhere in the world, particularly in the Middle East and in China. And the viability of refineries, not just in Scotland or the rest of the UK, but in this part of Europe, are actually being driven down by that international competitiveness. So we've been in discussion with the joint venture for some time around making sure that there is a future for the Grangemouth site and looking at all the possible options for a just transition, the points that we've raised previously around hydrogen, carbon capture and a biorefinery. But as I say, the first time that we're made aware of the decision itself was at the same time as the workforce, which actually I have to say is an admirable thing that, and a credible thing that the joint venture chose to tell their workforce first and tell them at the same time as they told ourselves.
In the previous session, though, I appreciate you may not have heard it, but Ian Hardy, the head of legal affairs at Petronas, seemed to suggest that the government were pretty much made aware a year ago that the refinery was likely to close. Not the date, but that the refinery was likely to close. Would that be accurate?
I would have to go back to look at minutes of and look at previous discussions, but certainly we've been aware for some time that there is, for a long time, because as I say, there have been previous interventions that the future of the refinery was at risk, and that's why we've been engaging heavily with them to ensure that there is a just transition, but also that there is a investment in the import terminal, which ensures the energy security for Scotland and other parts of the UK. It's, again, an important investment that the joint venture is making that so that when a decision is eventually taken on the refinery itself, we have continued industrial capacity there and we have energy security around the Grangemouth site and the fuels that are needed for the transport sector across Scotland.
So given the time, and it just seems that we're told that the government's just transition plan for Grangemouth will likely come up sometime next year. I mean, you know, that's maybe less than a year away from the refinery itself closing. I mean, are we dealing with this urgently enough? I mean, that plan, what potential impact will that plan have in supporting those workers that are likely to lose their jobs from 2025? I mean, it does look as if the timescale is not urgently enough. I mean, we've already heard the concerns over the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. I'm absolutely unclear what they've done. We don't even seem to have an assessment of the job losses that are likely to result because of this announcement. We know there'll be 400 direct jobs likely, but we don't seem to know what the impact will be in the supply chain. So do you think you're dealing with this urgently enough, given that this just transition plan might come out less than a year away from the refinery actually closing?
Yes, because we've been engaging with the joint venture for some time and ensuring that the investment has been made on the import terminal to give us assurance on the supply of energy security for Scotland and ensuring that we have a just transition plan coming in ahead of any decision being taken, because there's no final decision being taken yet around the future of the refinery. The decision that has been taken is to give the investment certainty for the import terminal, which allows for the transition of the site and ensures that the energy security needs are met. Obviously, we'll continue to engage with the joint venture, with the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, of which we're members, the UK government and the trade unions around maximising the job opportunities that are there, looking at how we can support the wider Grangemouth site on the opportunities that are there for further wider job opportunities so that the concerns that Mr Smith fairly articulates are addressed as best as we possibly can in an interaction with a commercial decision that has been taken by Petronas.
But, you know, in terms of jobs, and this is what a just transition is, you've got several hundred jobs at risk here, but even the investment in that import facility is likely only to have 100 direct jobs. What I'm not clear about is what work's taking place in order to secure employment for those existing workforce in the refinery and the many, although we seem to, don't seem to know what the number is, but the many supply chain jobs that are being affected. I mean, what work has been done? You've talked about working with the company around the import facility, around security of energy, but or supply, but what about the jobs, the hundreds of jobs at the refinery at the moment? What work is taking place to secure a future for them? Because these are workers, highly skilled workers, that are likely to be looking to leave the company because they are effectively being told their jobs are likely, let's be honest, likely to be lost come 2025.
So, there are a number of elements within this. We've been doing a lot of work through the Grangemouth Future Industry Board around looking at opportunities that there are for the Grangemouth site to ensure that there's continued industrial activity, recognising the fact that one aspect here, the refinery, is over 100 years old, or approaching 100 years old, rather, and is not competitive on an international stage in terms of other refineries around the world, as has been set out by your previous panel. So we have been engaging on that work. We also know that these are highly skilled workers. We don't know the final quantum of potential job losses because we are working still with assumptions around what may be lost and what may be retained in terms of an import terminal. But we do know that they're highly skilled workers. We know that they're going to be much in demand across the energy sector. What I'm keen to do through the Just Transition Plan is to ensure that there is as much opportunity as possible here to retain them here in Scotland. The other element that that Mr. Smith spoke about is about how the joint venture can retain those workers here until for as long as the refinery is operational. This was a question that both myself and the First Minister posed to Mr. Hardy and his colleagues when we met a couple of weeks ago, I believe that there is significant investment being made in order to retain staff, recognising the fact that this is an uncertain time for them. We have impressed upon them the importance of making sure that they're looking after that workforce, retaining them, and it's obviously in their interest to be doing so to ensure that they continue to have a viable workforce to continue the processes that are in place at the refinery.
I suppose the issue, though, is around supply chain and contractor jobs. The direct employment at the site are very high skilled. It may very well be that they'll pursue opportunities elsewhere, but that could mean leaving Grangemouth, so that's not just transition. But it is around those supply chain jobs. I'm just wondering, in your discussions with the company, this is obviously a site of critical national infrastructure. Is there any policy interventions at all in your discussions with the company that would allow them to, I suppose, continue beyond, notwithstanding we don't know the exact date, but it looks like 2025, but is there any policy interventions from either the Scottish Government or the UK Government that would allow that site to continue for a longer period than it looks as if it's likely to?
Those are the exact questions that I have asked of the site management when I met them previously, and also the joint venture shareholders when I met them yesterday, and the discussions and work is ongoing around that. But I wish to underline, this is an incredibly challenging situation where the projections for the margins for the site, I think the team said that they're in a stable financial situation at the moment, but they haven't been in the past. There has been a substantial subsidy and investment come from the joint venture in order to retain this going forward. So I don't wish to set unrealistic expectations in terms of what might be possible or what would be considered by the joint venture to be necessary to see the refinery go beyond 2025. But as Mr. Smith would expect, those are exactly the discussions and the points being raised with the joint venture that we are having active discussions around what may be possible there. And the other point, the earlier part of Mr. Smith's question was around the supply chain. And I think in response to Maggie Chapman, I addressed this, that we're assessing the situation in terms of the supply chain. But we have to recognise that when there is a transition from It's been a refinery, to be an import terminal. There is going to be substantial supply chain activity that will be maintained by its very nature, but we're needing to do more work on examining exactly what that's going to look like.
Okay. Make some progress. Colin Beattie to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Mayor. Coming to the Green Freeport, how does the plan change to import activity align with the aims of the Green Freeport policy? And are you satisfied that this would represent the type of additionality that this policy was intended to encourage?
So obviously the Green Freeport is going to capture significant activity beyond the Grangemouth site, and we're looking to make sure that there are opportunities taken advantage of it through the Green Freeport, such as supplying manufacturing and other services for the offshore renewable sector and other industrial activity. Clearly, you know, this is a decision that's been taken on a commercial basis by the joint venture, I suspect regardless of the status of the Freeport status being there, and actually has been taken with a wider macroeconomic situation at play. So I'm happy to have a further discussion around the Green Freeport and what our ambitions are for it, but I don't think this has had a particular bearing on the decision that's been taken.
Apparently not, but the previous panel, when we were discussing this with them, didn't seem to me to have a very clear idea of where the new import hub would fit in with the Green Freeport. I would have hoped there was an opportunity there as much as anything else. It just seemed a wee bit vague, and I'm not sure if you heard that part of the discussion, but I would have hoped for something a little more positive.
I'm happy to take that away and also explore it with the joint venture as well. I didn't hear that part of the discussion, but like I say, I'm happy to take that away, come back to the committee with more detail around that and speak to the joint venture around what their assumptions are.
Okay, thank you.
Kevin Stewart to be followed by Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. The previous panel, Mr Pritchard in particular, was keen to stress that the announcement would not have any impact on the plans for the Scottish Cluster and the Acorn project. Would that be the Cabinet Secretary's understanding, and how is the Scottish Government going to continue to scrutinise this to make sure that that's the case?
No, that is absolutely my understanding. That was one of the first questions that I had to ensure I was confident in. And even with an import terminal, there will continue to be hydrocarbons produced. There will continue to be elements of flaring, is my understanding, where there is substantial carbon could be captured from the refinery or moving to an import terminal. And the wider Grangemouth site obviously has significant carbon emissions that can be captured. So, you know, not just from discussions with the joint venture, but also with the cluster that I had a couple of weeks ago in Aberdeen, Grangemouth is absolutely central to their plans.
Thank you. There have been discussions this morning as well around about hydrogen production, around about the biorefinery project, some discussion around about sustainable aviation fuel. The previous panel were keen to talk about importing sustainable aviation fuel. Cabinet Secretary, have you had any discussions with the UK government and with other partners around about manufacturing sustainable aviation fuel? As Orcadian yourself, you realise the essential fact that aviation has to play here in Scotland as we move forward still. What can be done to try and ensure that Scotland plays a part in the manufacturing of SAF, and can that be done at Grangemouth as part of that just transition?
So I appreciate Mr Stewart's question, and obviously we touched on some of this last week when we were talking about Glasgow Prestwick, and there are challenges here around feedstock. There are also challenges around regulation that I think Mr. Hardy articulated well, and are continuing to make the case to the UK government to have a regulatory environment that would support the investment in the production of sustainable aviation fuel is obviously something that I'm looking to pursue, and I would encourage the committee to look at that in more detail as well, because obviously this has an important critical role to play for some of our strategic assets. We spoke about Glasgow Prestwick, but also the connectivity, as Mr. Stewart articulates, my own heritage in Orkney, but other island groups as well, but also for us to be connected internationally, and the role that that plays in us seeking to continue to grow the Scottish economy and the important role that that plays.
Thank you. Also discussion this morning about energy security, around about the impacts of international markets. One of the points that was raised by the first panel this morning in terms of that import hub plan was diesel coming in at Finnart and going to Grangemouth through the existing pipeline. I asked questions around about the carbon footprint of importing that diesel. You yourself earlier talked about the international market and China and refineries in the Middle East being much more modern much more competitive. But the carbon footprint of importing from China, from the Middle East, or wherever it may be, is huge. You know, while it may well be that our carbon footprint reduces if there's no refinery at Grangemouth, the carbon footprint of importing could actually be greater. So has there been any look, and I recognise that this is the UK government's responsibility, any look at seeing if we can utilise the Forties pipeline more, taking crude from the North Sea basin, and continuing to refine at the likes of Grangemouth, which, from an energy security point of view in this weird and wonderful world that we live in, is probably the best way. And also that would cut down on the carbon footprint of importing, whether that be diesel, petrol, kerosene, or even as we move forward, the likes of SAF.
I thank Mr. Stewart for that, and he will be aware that there are industrial reasons as to why we already have to import significant amounts of oil and gas, particularly oil, into Scotland, and that is because of the high sulphur content, my understanding is, of North Sea oil. And so while I absolutely appreciate the point that Mr. Stewart is making, and agree that, you know, from a carbon footprint perspective, you know, the current situation and that going forward, you know, to a lesser or greater degree, we are offshoring our carbon footprint rather than taking responsibility for it. I understand that. That is the situation as we face it right now, because I think it's only around 30% of North Sea oil is actually refined at Grangemouth because of the industrial reasons that are well set out.
So I'm aware of the high sulphur content and the fact that crude from the North Sea basin goes elsewhere, and there were talk of other refineries in Northwest Europe today as well. But maybe the investment in a new refinery, a modernised refinery, if the UK government were willing to do that, could take account of the high sulphur content of crude from the North Sea basin in order to get to the right end products in terms of diesel, petrol and kerosene. Now, I'm no expert in this, Cabinet Secretary, but I've been told on many occasions by folks who are experts that refineries have got their own peak point, if you like, in terms of dealing with certain crudes. maybe we could do that in terms of Grangemouth as we move on? And is that a discussion that's worth having with the UK government, who have the primary responsibility here, in order to continue to ensure that we have energy security and to stop that importation and to reduce carbon footprint?
I think having that discussion as part of the mix has to be there. I don't know if the committee have reached out to have the UK government appear before it.
The UK government are attending on the 17th of January. That's the date we've managed to confirm.
So. That's helpful to know, and that's maybe a question that could be posed there.
Can I just a little bit
in terms of whether it would be economic for Grangemouth to build a whole new refinery to use more oil from the North Sea. But one of the issues which we understand is causing pressure on refineries across the world, and particularly in Europe, is the scale of operation, and that the unfortunately Scotland has only got a relatively small population in terms of the size of the refinery, and to invest in a really large, very modern refinery probably wouldn't make economic sense in terms of the throughput of product. There isn't the market for a really large new refinery.
So, sorry to interrupt, but I think one of the reasons why I've asked the questions that I have is quite simply because it's not just Scotland here, it's what is the setup of the refineries in the rest of the UK, or even in that triangle, because the folk from Petro-Ineos talked about the Antwerp, Rotterdam, Amsterdam situation. What is the situation in the northwest of Europe at this moment in terms of age and capability of refineries? We recognise that oil and gas will still have some part to play in the future, a significant part in some instances, and it would be much better to deal with that here than it would be to import from some of the more modern refineries that have been mentioned in the Middle East and China, not only from the carbon footprint point of view, but also from the energy security point of view. So I think there has to be a holistic look at this, and that's questions I'll ask the UK government to make up.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Murdo Fraser, who also has questions around energy security. He'll be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd just like to follow up on Kevin Stewart's line of questioning around energy security. There are currently six refineries across the UK. Grangemouth, we understand, is set to close. We're not aware that there are plans to close the others. That means, as we heard from the first panel, that customers in Scotland currently being supplied via Grangemouth will be having to source supplies from elsewhere. That might be elsewhere in the UK or elsewhere in the world. And yet we're still producing oil and gas from the North Sea basin. So I suppose my question to the Scottish Government is, do you have any concerns about energy security, given that we're losing this capacity within Scotland to refine crude oil?
So there's two elements, again, to Murdo Fraser's question. The first part around where customers are going to be able to source their fuel is incorrect, because the transition to an import terminal means that they can still source their fuels from Grangemouth. The second part around energy security is obviously the responsibility of the UK government, and I believe a minister will be before you in the new year to answer those questions. But the assurance that I have received, both from the joint venture and from UK ministers, is that there are contingency plans in place around Grangemouth, both now and going forward, and that the transitional arrangements that have been announced for the import terminal is all about ensuring that there is energy security going forward.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. I wonder if you would accept, however, that because Grangemouth is closing, there will still be demand for oil and gas in Scotland. That demand will be there probably for decades to come, even with a just transition, because we know that that demand will exist. In effect, what we are doing is we are exporting those jobs. So that demand will still be there. It's just that the jobs won't be here anymore.
No, again, I don't believe that's the case either, because the transition that we're making to green energy sources And also the continued operations at Grangemouth means that there is going to be job opportunities for people here in Scotland in the energy sector going forward. And there is going to be a utilisation and need to utilise the highly skilled technical expertise, particularly in the subsea elements, but also in the refinery elements, to ensure our green industrial revolution can continue. So I don't take the premise of Mr. Fraser's question with respect. I think there will still be huge opportunities for people to be able to work in Scotland in the energy sector for many decades to come, regardless of whether that is in the oil and gas or a green energy sector.
Okay, so just to follow that up then, if you were speaking today to a worker at Grangemouth, one of the 400 who's potentially looking at losing their jobs over the next 18 months, might be longer, but it might be 18 months, what assurances can you give them that within the green economy, they're likely to find a job, they'll be able to utilise their skill set?
That's exactly why that's exactly what we would point to the work that's been done on the Just Transition Plan and indeed the Green Industrial Strategy that's going to be coming out early in the new year as well, in order to give that certainty for people that are currently working in traditional oil and gas sectors, the energy sectors, that there will be job opportunities coming forward because of the many and diverse projects that we hope to be able to secure in order to have a strong manufacturing industrial supply chain that's going to feed the green energy opportunities that we have coming forward, whether that is in pumped hydro storage, whether it's in offshore, onshore wind, floating or offshore wind, in the marine energy sector, or indeed hydrogen and production and utilisation. There are going to be many opportunities for people with a high skill level that we see at Grangemouth to be able to transition to other job opportunities and to retain them here in Scotland. That is an absolutely critical factor in the work that we are doing, and it's an absolute ambition of ours to ensure that we retain as many of those workers here in Scotland.
And will these new jobs come online quickly enough so that those who potentially lose their jobs at Grangemouth will be able to benefit from them?
We're already seeing some of that transition in action. I was in Aberdeen a couple of weeks ago and opened the new SSEN offices in Aberdeen. And I believe that the level is a third of their workforce have transitioned already from the oil and gas sector. That transition is already happening, for Mr. Fraser's confidence.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Just as an addition to Mr. Fraser's question about the gap, you've talked about jobs in Aberdeen. For people who live in the central belt here in Grangemouth, it's because the plans are, I know that INEOS have a longer sightline of what they want to do on the site, but that's not going to happen by 2025. So it's, yeah. Are the opportunities going to be in the central belt and not just in the northeast?
I understand that, and that's a fair point. I use the example of SSE in the northeast as an example, but obviously there are jobs being created across Scotland, and there will be job opportunities there. And obviously for the Grangemouth site, we're looking to take forward opportunities, as I've said, through the Future Industries Board and our Just Transition Plan, but also the work that we're doing with the joint venture, UK government and others, around trying to make sure that there's continued industrial capacity and new opportunities, hydrogen, carbon capture, the biorefinery coming forward, and to ensure that those are happening as quickly as possible, recognising some of those are at a more advanced stage and depend upon decisions not within our making. Some of those are decisions that are out with our control, but we continue to push hard to see progress on those areas.
Thank you. Brian Whittle to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. As we heard earlier, the wider impact on sort of the decarbonisation programme of the closure here is was that I would argue this the opposite, quite frankly, that there's a carbonisation, if you like, offshoring refining and then also importing the refined product into Scotland. So to combat that, following from Murdo Fraser's question there, what we need to do is develop that site and develop, as a major industrial hub.
one of the biggest in Scotland. One of the big, they're already working with blue hydrogen. They're talking this morning potentially going into green hydrogen. We've talked about the development of SAF. And one of the biggest barriers to development of hydrogen at scale is the initial capex that's required to develop the size of the site required to develop hydrogen at scale. So they have the infrastructure there. They also have the skilled jobs. And one of the things they said this morning was that that came out loud and clear to me was that, it's government policies, decisions, support that will need to improve, make that move much quicker to allow the jobs to be there for those workers who are going to lose their current jobs. And just to, I know you said earlier on about what you're already doing this and we're already creating jobs. I spoke to a recruitment company who are currently stripping out the oil and gas sector in the North Sea, and almost exclusively they're going abroad. We need to move quicker on this. So can I ask Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government are doing to ensure that we do develop into to that site into a hydrogen hub, into a SAF hub, as well as an import hub?
I thank Mr Whittle for those questions. It perhaps wasn't made clear this morning around the policy barriers that there are to some of these investments coming forward, but they are policy areas that are reserved to the UK government. So these are made, yes, they are. These are areas that perhaps Mr Whittle can raise, as we are raising, around providing policy certainty on the regulation of the usage and transportation of hydrogen, which is part of the most recent energy bill that has been passed at a UK level. Mr Whittle will be able to raise that with whichever UK minister comes before them. And to be fair, I think this is an area where I hope we can have close collaboration and a shared understanding of the opportunity before us and the need for us to move fast, as Mr. Whittle had said. So that's on the hydrogen part. On the carbon capture part, you know, he'll know very well the fact that we need the Track 2 status confirmation. We need progress to be made there so that the continued investment can happen, because that is alongside the use of hydrogen as a fuel. The carbon capture elements are, you know, the greatest way of decarbonising that industrial cluster. And that's why we have had an aspiration for years to see progress on carbon capture, and now to see progress on hydrogen happening as well. For the areas that we have responsibility for, we will do what we can to progress as quickly as possible. But on the main parts of these, in terms of the barriers that Mr Hardy, I believe, was describing this morning, those are with the UK government.
Martin, the main barrier to hydrogen is actually potential for offtake. And that was said this morning as well. And I mean, the Scottish Government itself are investing in the development of green hydrogen. You have a fund, as does the UK have a fund. And I'm pleased to hear that actually they're starting to work closer together to develop that. But it is round offtake, and it is if there's no offtake, they won't develop the hydrogen. And I totally accept around SAF. I think they're not moving quick enough on SAF, and we'll end up importing far too much of that when we have, as we discussed last week, Cabinet Secretary. But I'm going to push back again. What the Scottish Government have to do is make sure that the site at Grangemouth is developed to its full, or utilised to its fullest, because that kind of capex investment is something that is probably beyond our current ability to develop from scratch. So to decarbonise, we're going to have to utilise that site to its full. So I'm asking you what support the Scottish Government are going to do to make sure that happens.
The offtake is there, as was articulated by the panel this morning. The offtake is on the site. So the production on the site and the usage on the site is to decarbonise the energy supply that they need for their processes on the site. So that offtake concern, I think, was addressed this morning. It's already...
What he did say was, if you play back, that they could increase capacity there and actually use on other sites as well and on other areas. And that, I think that is, for me, what I'm asking is that we're behind the curve on the development of hydrogen in this country and the offtake, and we have a huge opportunity. So, yes, currently there's production, the offtake is at the site, but they did say they have the capability, given the right policies and the right support,
to develop more for other areas.
And again, the regulation of the transportation of hydrogen thereafter is, you know, still to be confirmed with the UK government. But the offtake, which is the, my understanding, you know, obviously the joint venture will need to, and INEOS will need to explain this in more detail. My understanding is that the offtake is there, which is making the commercial decision for the decarbonisation of the production that they are utilising. The previous question that Mr Whittle raised was around jobs and around retaining as many people in the oil and gas sector as possible. That is my shared ambition, as is Mr Whittle's, to see as many people as possible retained in the energy sector in particular, but in other opportunities that may exist here in Scotland. They're a highly skilled, highly valued workforce that we want to see a just transition for. So I don't deny that there are competing opportunities around the world. I want to ensure through the work that we're doing, particularly utilising a supply chain that, for the offshore wind sector and the green industrial strategy that we're developing, that we can show a line of sight for people to have a strong energy-related career in the green industries here in Scotland.
Thank you,
Gideon. I don't know if... Susie, did you want to come in back in?
I was just going to add, one of the decisions which we're expecting this year from UK government is on the hydrogen blending, how much hydrogen could be blended into the gas grid, which will obviously, as that progresses, if there's a decision to allow a significant amount of hydrogen to be blended into the gas grid, that will provide some surety around off-takers going forward.
Just for clarity, currently it's around about 10%, but looking to bring it up to 20%, is that right?
That's what we believe might be the case, and certainly from Scottish Government's perspective, we're hoping that there will be a decision around the 20% mark.
Okay, thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, panel. Cabinet Secretary, can you share with the committee whether you've had any discussions with North Sea oil and gas firms about the impact of the closure of Grangemouth and what it might mean for their business plans and their business plans and their business models?
I can reassure Ms Tweed that I have regular conversations both with individual oil and gas firms around their current operations and also what I hope will be continued investment in green energy going forward, the just transition that we want to see, and also industry representatives. So I had a meeting very recently with Offshore Energy UK and also had a meeting on the same day with the Scottish cluster and interested parties around that, and which was able to give confirmation to previous questions, give comfort to the fact that this decision to have a transition from a refinery to an import terminal will not have an impact on the Scottish cluster.
Okay, that's reassuring. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just another question around timescales. So other members have asked the Cabinet Secretary what has to be done if the life of the refinery was to be extended. And you have said you're in discussions with Scottish Government and with business. But does the Scottish Government have... We were expecting the Just Transition Plan in spring. Will that include an assessment of how long the refinery could be open for? And is it different from spring 25? Do you have an alternative idea of how long that should be open if it were to manage... If it was a just transition, it needs to be managed, and this doesn't feel... if we're looking at Spring 25, particularly managed in terms of the local community in particular?
So we have been given some warning here, which is helpful in terms of the work that we're doing with the Just Transition Plan, that the potential date for the refinery closure is Q2 2025, which allows us to ensure that our Just Transition Plan is tailored, that allows us to make sure that the work that we're doing, both with the joint venture, the other businesses involved in Grangemouth, other interested parties, including the meeting I had last week with the local authority concerned, ensures that we're doing everything that we can to bring forward a just transition plan that gives people confidence around the opportunities that will be available in and around Grangemouth.
And in terms of the Green Freeport, I mean, it does look from the outside that you've got a refinery and a business that is now moving to an import-export at the same time that a Green Freeport's been set up that will have tax breaks and incentives for imports and exports, but we've been told that there's no connection between the two.
But my understanding is that there is no connection. That my understanding, and I think it was articulated, to be fair, this morning again, that this is about wider macroeconomic conditions rather than any decision-making, to be fair, by either the Scottish or the UK government, which I assume would include the decisions around the Green Freeport.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of importing, I asked the panel this morning around, I mean, you've talked about offsetting, you know, the carbon activity has just been moved somewhere else. You're offshore and it still has to happen. You're importing it refined products. But are you planning to do any assessment of where the refined products are coming from and how they are being refined? Because there are, you know, other countries that won't have the same health and safety conditions that we do for our workers and won't be refining to the same standards that we do. How do we know that the imports are of the same quality of what we produce in Scotland?
So obviously we have an assessment based on previous studies around where the oil is currently being imported from and have an understanding of that. We don't have a huge amount of control, as you'll expect, in these commercial decisions that are taken on where to source from. But obviously we would want, and the Mr. Hardy said this morning that this would that they are wanted to make sure that the decisions they take on where they source their product from meet international standards to ensure, and I would assume that that includes health and safety, but also the standards around the production of those products as well.
And a number of members have asked about energy security, and no doubt we'll pick that up with the UK Government Minister when they're here in January. But at a time of, you know, increased global instability, for us to be increasingly reliant on imports doesn't really seem like the long-term planning that...
Well, indeed, which is exactly the reason why we need a transition for the energy that we use. We need to rely, I think, alongside the environmental and the economic, the energy security argument of transitioning our energy dependence away from hydrocarbons to energy, renewable energy that we produce and can source here is one that I think is pretty obvious. And that's why
we're not moving at the pace for that to be in place by spring 25.
Well, there's no, obviously there's going to be, there's going to be a continued demand, and we understand and know that there's going to be a continued demand for some of the products from oil and gas going forward. But those are also going to be continue to be diminishing. Those are going to be reducing demands. And that's why we need to make, and this will be over some time, I grant you. But in the meantime, the decision that the joint venture has taken to make the investment in the import-export terminal means that from an energy security perspective, that is maintained, which I think is a good thing. And that is something that, again, you will wish to explore with UK ministers who have a responsibility here. But I think that is on the decision and when it's taken on what happens with the refinery, I understand the data on that is an important consideration. But to have the assurance that we have the import terminal to ensure whenever that decision is taken that we have continued energy security is a vital component in all of this.
Okay, I have two additional members who are joining us this morning. If Stephen Kerr, would you like to? If the Cabinet Secretary has time, I realise we're at the...
Yeah, so go ahead, Mr. Kerr.
The Cabinet Secretary will know that as a Central Scotland MSP, my number one concern is about the constituents who are directly impacted by all this. Would it be fair to say, judging by what you have said this morning, you're not optimistic about the future of the refinery? You've mentioned once, I think, in your answers this morning about extending the life of the refinery. You're not optimistic about that, are you?
No, I don't want to set unrealistic expectations. I think you know, previous interventions that have been had here to extend the refinery capacity there have been in a different time, both in terms of an international perspective, but also from a domestic demand perspective as well. So all I'm wanting to do is explore every single opportunity that there may be alongside UK government colleagues for extending the life of the of the refinery. I think Mr Kerr would expect that of both parties. But I don't want to make false promises as to what might be possible there. I just want to make sure, demonstrating to Mr Kerr's regional constituents and those that are spread wider, that we're doing everything possible.
So one of the things that I've raised this morning was the status of the hydrocracker, which is a key component in terms of the running of the refinery, but also in financial terms, its profitability. What have Petroennians told you about what is going on with the hydrocracker?
Very similar to what was discussed this morning. This is obviously an operational matter for them, and they continue to look at ensuring that they can restart the hydrocracker as quickly as possible in the safest way possible.
And are you content that that is the intention of the business?
Yes.
Okay.
That's certainly what's been articulated to me and was articulated to you as a committee this morning.
It was indeed. You weren't surprised about the announcement in the same way the rest of us were surprised. You had a year's notice that this was likely to happen, yes?
No, I wasn't. I don't think anybody should have been particularly surprised about the announcement in itself. The timing, we got told the same time as the workforce, so the timing, there was an element of surprise there for certain. But we're talking about a century-old refinery that has previously had issues, that there have been significant interventions made previously, and a significant subsidy provided by the joint venture over a number of years. So no, there wasn't a great surprise, and I don't think there should have been to others, that this was a possibility. The important consideration for the Scottish Government and indeed the UK Government is obviously energy security. It is about making sure that there is continued industrial capacity there. That is something that we have been working with the joint venture on and will continue to do so.
Yeah, I think for the people of the area it came as a great shock. I mean, I understand what you're saying about the macro position and markets and all the rest of it, but if you live in that area, it came as a big shock to hear that it was very likely, in fact, almost certain, that the refinery is going to close in the spring of 2025. So the economic impact of this closure, when will the government be in a position to publish an economic impact assessment of the closure? Because at the minute, as was raised earlier by Colin Smith, not very clear exactly what the implications, the ramifications are of the refinery closing. So when will the government produce its economic impact assessment?
That work is ongoing. With respect to Mr Kerr, the discussion that we've had already has articulated that we're still working with other parties around understanding exactly what the decision to close the refinery is likely to have, but also, importantly, what the mitigation of the import terminal will have, and also what other possible investments that we've spoken about, hydrogen, carbon capture, a potential biorefinery may have in addition. So that work is ongoing and we'll continue to work to publish that as quickly as we can. But an additional consideration here is that the final decision has not been taken yet, though I grant Mr Kerr the point that you know, we're in a very difficult situation about the refinery post 2025. And so my energy at the moment is directed at understanding what is going to be important for the joint venture and making the decision that they do around when the refinery is going to close and what we can do to assist, if there is anything, the extension of the refinery.
Yeah, the economic impact assessment will no doubt be holistic. We'll consider multiple possible outcomes to the situation we're in. But I think we can all agree, and I think the convener mentioned earlier, there's little doubt that the refinery is closing.
I haven't disputed that. It's the timing.
Yeah.
It's the timing that is still uncertain.
But irrespective of the timing, a holistic economic impact assessment would consider all of those factors. So it's very critical, I think, to the path ahead that we understand what happens because of the closure of the refinery, whenever that does happen, for definite. So this piece of work, who is doing it and what is the estimation of when it will be available for all of us, for the people of the area, so that we can begin to get our head around the nature, the extent, the scope of this challenge, which undoubtedly it is.
Yeah, so we continue to work with the partners on the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. We continue to have discussions with the UK government on these areas, and we'll continue to work on a just transition plan that will obviously have a consideration and will have an articulation on some of these areas as well, to ensure that we are giving information but also comfort to the communities that are central to all of this, the people that are central to all of this, that there is future job opportunities, future industrial capacity, and a just transition that can be achieved for that area.
So maybe my question wasn't clear, Convener, but who is undertaking the economic impact assessment, and when is it likely to be able to be published and available? Those are my critical questions.
We're continuing to do that work. We are doing that work. We're continuing to do that work, and understand alongside other parties, including enterprise agencies, including the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. But as I said, the critical element that we've got before us is helping to inform the decision that the joint venture will be taking around the future of the refinery itself. Now, obviously, we understand that there is going to be an economic impact from that, and we'll continue to work on what that looks like and take an assessment and alongside other parties. And
so we'll it's yourself that's responsible for producing?
We will be, yeah. This is a wider responsibility beyond the Scottish Government. It has a UK Government element to it as well. And we need to work with all parties involved to ensure that we're coming up with the information that we need to take decisions that we need to take around, for instance, just transition plan, the work on the potential opportunities that there are for future industrial use of the site, and we'll continue to do all we can to pull that together as best we can.
A holistic economic impact assessment would take care of that.
Yeah.
Will that be available in the first quarter?
We'll continue to work on that. We're continuing to work on that. I don't want to give any definitive timescales or dates around what we'll be able to publish.
The Just Transition Commission published a report today that says the current path will not deliver a just transition, and they're calling for a detailed and specific set of policies, actions and investments. Is that what we can expect from the Grangemouth report when it comes in the spring? And you'll know that we're also looking at North East Scotland. We're currently doing an inquiry into just transition for North East Scotland. So the criticism from the Commission is that while the high-level policy and approach is maybe embedded, there's a lack of action. Will the delivery plans give us that, and the committee will scrutinise that when it's published?
I would expect the committee to scrutinise it and other committees across Parliament as well. Obviously, we will reflect the concerns of the Just Transition Commission and take those on board as we continue to work up the Just Transition Plan that we'll be publishing early next year.
OK, thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary and officials for attending this morning, and I suspend the meeting and move in. Sorry, did you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. Just to add one point to that, we are, in response to the action, the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth will contain a detailed action plan that will set out all of that. Clearly, that will be an iterative process as it reflects the emerging situation in terms of technology globally and all that, but the plan itself will have an action plan that sets out what actions will be taken in terms of the wider Grangemouth cluster when that's published in the spring.
OK, thank you. As I said, the committee will no doubt scrutinise that once it's published. So I thank the Cabinet Secretary and officials for attending this morning, and I suspend the meeting as we move into private session.